we're getting back. We're getting back. Just a quick show of hands. Who here would love a great way to demonstrate your security proficiency to leads when you meet them? Yes? Is that interesting to you guys? All right, cool. So you're in the right place. That's what Danny's going to walk you through today, and I will let Danny from ThreatLocker take it away.
Thank you.
Yep.
So before we begin, nobody came up and guessed at the booth, so I'm going to give one more chance. Okay, so I've got a senior tech here, not the type of guy that's going to get phished on an email. I'm able to get his RMM password and copy malware onto his machine without a vulnerability and without phishing him. Anyone want to take one more guess for the $100? Go ahead. Nope. Offered what for his employees?
Did you compromise one of his employees?
Nope. Nope. And have to how would I install the keylogger? Okay. Go on, one more try. Go ahead. Sorry? Nope. Okay. We're going to demonstrate that in 15 minutes, but for now we'll talk about the boring stuff like how to actually sell cybersecurity when you can demonstrate you can hack their environment. The most likely way anybody is going to go out of business today is not COVID, is not strikes, is not your building burning down, but is a cyber attack. And you guys are more vulnerable than any of your customers. You've got two areas of attack. One is if your customers get attacked. The other one is if you get attacked. If you remember the good old days, back when internet was dial-up, and or slow at least, and we had an antivirus, we had a firewall, we had a backup solution, and maybe we had a patch management solution. That was our security stack. That's what it looked like. And getting a virus stung, but it really wasn't that bad. I was working for a big company, multinational company in 2001, and the love bug came out. Everybody got the love bug. And guess what it did? It told you I love you, and then emailed all your contacts telling you I love you. That was pretty bad. That was the most notorious virus of all times. And defending against those viruses was kind of child's play, too. A lot of 90s movies. This is what happens when I deal with the slides and not the marketing department. So I'll give you a heads up on that. But it was kind of child's play to defend against viruses, and then if you got it wrong, it didn't matter. And this is the thing. When we fix those viruses, when I fix the love bug, when I fix someone's pop-ups on their computer, their slow computer, we were the heroes. The IT guys were the heroes. Everybody loved you. I remember in the UK, they have these chocolates called Quality Street. And they have a song and a commercial saying, thank you very much song. And if you want to thank somebody, you give them these Quality Street chocolates. It's a fantastic marketing campaign. And I remember somebody giving me a box of Quality Streets to say, thank you for removing the malware from my computer. How often does that happen now? We were the heroes. But then the attacks got worse. And not a little bit worse, but much, much worse. World-ending worse. Anybody here ever dealt with Emotet? Okay. Emotet is kind of like, did anyone watch the movie Terminator? I know. No? Really? I'm not that old. So at the end of the Terminator, this machine gets up, and Kyle Reese wants to blow him to pieces, and he shoves a piece of dynamite in the Terminator's stomach, blows him to pieces, and then it still gets back up and grabs the woman's leg. That's kind of like Emotet. It just won't go away. It won't die. Every time you think you've cleaned it, it's spread to another machine. The hash keeps changing. It will self-sign on your computer. It just will not disappear, and it's one of the worst viruses to get rid of. And the other thing is, it actually steals your banking data, your credentials. It harvests information. It's a really nasty virus. Today's malware is like that across the board. When was the last piece of malware that you got that said, I love you? It doesn't do that anymore. It steals your files, it encrypts your data, it harvests your data, and it never ends. And the harder the malware is to detect, the harder it is to get rid of, the worse the malware is, the more your clients hate you. So I was talking to a client, just signing up for ThreatLocker, trying to get rid of Emotet, and he said that we're going to lose this customer. They're so mad. We've been working on this for 3 weeks now. And he's working all hours. I mean, he's on a call with me at 1 o'clock in the morning, still trying to get rid of this thing. And his customer is hating him more and more, when really they should be thanking him and worshiping the ground he walks on, because he's the guy who's solving the problems. And the other problem is these attackers, they're getting more tactical. Virus used to be, I'm going to send this I love you out, or I'm going to send this piece of malware out to as many people as I can, and hopefully there's some stupid people in the crowd, they're going to click on it, and that's it. Today, they're actually planning their attacks. They're finding out who are your MSP, what's your backup, where's your backup stored, and they're getting all this data together before they even launch their attack, and then on a Friday night or on a Sunday evening, they say, okay, this guy's sleeping in his bed, I'm going to take over his business. And then tomorrow morning, he's going to come in and he's going to say, where's my files? And they're encrypting your files and your business is gone and you don't even know about it. And they've got your backups. Your cloud backups have been deleted or not functioning for 2 weeks, or they've been backing up one file on your computer. And you've been looking at these reports going, I've got a cloud backup. And they've taken over your entire network or your entire client base and you didn't even know it was happening. And then when they're ready, checkmate, that's when they strike their attack, not beforehand. And these wins are big for them. $8.5 billion was the cost of ransomware last year. $8 billion was the entire size of the antivirus industry. So it's better business to send ransomware than to defend against it. I think I can just leave now and do that. It's easier. these wins are big. Garmin paid $10 million to get their data back. And those wins are starting to be stopped a little bit too. Who read last week that the US Treasury Department is actually going after people who paid ransoms? Did you know when you pay a ransom, you might be breaking international sanction laws? These guys, they're criminals. There's sanctions issued against them. And if you pay a ransom to the wrong person, you or the person on your behalf can actually be fined or criminally prosecuted for paying that money to that foreign person. And here's the other thing. When they win, they don't just encrypt your files, and maybe you get your files back from your backup, and maybe you pay the money, and maybe you get them back, and maybe you don't get them back. And if you're still in business, they're capitalizing on their investment. So when they come in, you think, okay, I've restored for my backup, I'm smug, I've won. Anyone ever hear the expression, if you break a mirror, you get 7 years bad luck? The same applies to ransomware. Maybe that's a UK session. The same applies to ransomware. If you get ransomware, you've got 7 years bad luck following it. Because once they've got into your network, they've got information about you, who you do business with, your partners, your social security number, your tax returns. Who's got the tax return in their email? No one? Really? Nobody's emailed their tax return to their accountant or anyone? So there's a lot. That piece of information, when they're on your network encrypting your files, they read that and then they sell it. People can now steal your identity, apply for a credit card, or just find out who your accountant is and come in for another attack. They can go after your business partners. They can say, I know Neil does business with this guy here and he charges him $54 or $540 a month. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to email this guy and say, from Neil, I'm going to spoof his address, and I'm going to say, I've changed my bank account number. They know that relationship. They go after that data and then they keep getting hit and hit again. And that's why when you see clients get ransomware, they don't often get it once, they get it multiple times. And they get it multiple times, not because their users are stupid, which is part of the reason, but because the attacker or the attackers, because they don't even necessarily come back in and attack itself, they sell this on the black market for other attackers to use, it's coming back in over and over again. All these tidbits of information, airline tickets, birthdays, invoice amounts for customers, passwords, TV subscriptions. When you've been encrypted, assume all of this is compromised and assume you're about to have a 7-year bad luck. And the problem is, all this malware is getting harder to detect. And I beat up on antivirus a lot, and I beat up on threat detection a lot. But the reality is, they're trying. I mean, you've got to imagine, if I've got to stand in front of this room, and I've got to say, who is a bad person here? I want to detect the bad people. I mean, you look a little bit suspicious, and you look a little bit suspicious, but I mean, I really don't know who is good or bad. I mean, you could all be really nice people, or you could be serial killers, or I don't have a clue. And if you think about what antivirus and threat detection and threat hunting has to do, they have to look for trends of bad people. So if somebody comes to my door with rotten teeth, I kind of think, well, they look like a junkie. I don't want to let them in. And that's kind of what they're doing. But if some guy comes to this door and he's wearing a suit and he looks smart, he could be a con artist, he could be a thief, he could be an armed robber. I don't know. And threat detection's trying really hard to do this, but the reality is, it's not possible to detect every threat. It doesn't matter whether you've got an antivirus, a next-gen antivirus, an artificial intelligence antivirus, threat hunting, a SOC, or EDR. It's impossible to detect everything. And even if we could detect all this malware, these guys are using fileless malware against us. So last week, at the roadshow, we demonstrated with a rubber ducky how I could just use PowerShell and copy all the files up to the internet bypassing the EDR. We're not doing a rubber ducky today. We don't have time. But that's a great tool to use. And we have one out there if you want to come and take a look at it, how you can show your customers how easy it is to get into their systems. But there's attacks being launched from fileless malware, macros in Word documents that call PowerShell, Redshift, RunDLL, vulnerabilities in Internet Explorer last year where you could run any PowerShell command directly from a website without any interaction from the user. Zoom had vulnerabilities. Who uses Zoom? We're getting more people paying attention, I think. So who uses Zoom? I mean, Zoom had vulnerabilities in March. We can't just stop using these programs, but these programs are being weaponized and used against us all the time. So it's getting harder and harder to detect these threats. And then there's the other part, and this is becoming more and more common. How many of you have the letter L in your domain name? Anyone got the letter L in their company name? So I want you to do something. I want you to go home this evening or go out on your laptop after this, and I want you to register the domain replacing the L with an I. Because if you send an email, if I register your domain name, replace the L from an I can spoof your email account. I don't even need to spoof it. I can send an email with a capital I. It looks exactly the same in Outlook. The user will not be able to tell the difference. I can engage in a conversation with your customer, and I can even register the DMARC, and they're not going to have a clue that it's happening. And that's just one way. I could also just misspell it, and most people don't pay attention. But I can do it without the user being able to see just by using that method. And one of the attacks we've seen a lot with MSPs recently is the MSP being spoofed. So I find out that this customer belongs to this MSP. So I send an email to them saying, we've got a problem with Screen Connect today. Can you click on this TeamViewer link? They click on the TeamViewer link, and now I have access to their computer. One MSP called up ThreatLocker, signed up for ThreatLocker recently, and while I was doing a demo for him, he said one of our customers was compromised using TeamViewer. Not because TeamViewer was any worse than any other remote access tool, but because the user had clicked on it. And the first he heard of it was the customer was yelling at him, why are you looking at my saved passwords? The customer called him and started yelling, why do you need to see my saved passwords? And he didn't know. He thought this person was off their rocker. But an attacker had literally connected to the machines and started looking at the saved passwords in Chrome. That simple. So these tools are being used all the time. And all this work we're doing to protect our clients, all this work you're doing to protect your clients, you're the bad guys. When your clients get breached, you're the bad guys. When you try and tell them, here's more security, you should do this, somehow you've become the bad guys. And I don't think anyone's watched movies here by the sound of it, so I don't know if these analogies are going to be in any way relevant. But if anyone's watched this movie, Independence Day, the aliens have blown up the world. They've tried to shoot missiles at the spaceships, and they're not working. So the Secretary of Defense comes up with a logical conclusion. Let's nuke them. I mean, what else have we got? The country's in pieces. And somehow, he's the bad guy. And he's essentially the IT guy in this scenario. You're coming up with a solution, and they hate you. You're the bad guy. How do you fix that? How do you become the good guy? So first of all, we need to come up with a solution. We need to stop our clients being breached. We need to stop every single week or month dealing with some kind of cyber breach, some kind of phishing attack, and we need to stop chasing the threats. We can't chase every threat. You can't detect. There's over 2 million pieces of malware every day, and they're just the ones we know about. You can't chase every threat in the world. You have to build effective security from the ground up. I have a little triangle here that talks about security. I like to think of security as a triangle. And every part of security inside the triangle there is essentially an entry point. So you have applications, you have the endpoint, you have web and email, network perimeter, insider threat. These are all potentially entry points into our system. And there's three ways we can defend against any entry point. We can defend by the human layer, so we can train them. I don't really have much confidence in that, but we should do it. It's good faith. It beats cutting off their hands. So we can train the humans. If a user gets an email attachment with a piece of malware, and we can stop them opening it. And we can probably reduce our exposure from 60% to 40%. So we can do something. We can detect that threat. So we can hope that our antivirus, our EDR, our anti-threat hunting, our IDS is going to find the problem and detect it. And we are hoping, because it's not possible. Or we can put a control in place. And if we think about the network layer, when security really began and we put firewalls on our network, we didn't start off saying, somebody's connecting to our servers, we need to find a threat hunting system or threat detection system to detect these bad connections. We didn't do that. What we said is, why are our servers open on the internet? Why can everybody access? Why are all the ports open? Why are the web ports open? And what we did is we put a firewall in front of it, and we closed off all ports that weren't required to come into our servers. It's a very logical thing to do. And then as firewalls got more advanced, we added things like IDS, IPS to detect the threats on top of that. So when there was ports opened, we added the detection. Now take that to the endpoint, and let's look at what we do at the endpoint. We hope the user doesn't open the attachment. We all know how that goes. And then we add an antivirus and a next-gen antivirus and an EDR and a threat hunting and an MDR. And we've put no controls in place. We've done nothing to stop the file from being opened. If we were to take a simpler approach and say, OK, we're not just going to do this. We're going to use things like application whitelisting, which is a misconfused term a lot. So just to define it very clearly, a concept or a reality where you can say nothing runs unless it's approved by the business or by the IT department. What we have now is, let's take the same scenario. The user gets the piece of malware. They open the malware. Is it on the whitelist? No. It doesn't matter if it's a known virus or not. It gets blocked. So by using these absolute controls, it puts us in charge of the environment. I'm not going to spend too much time on getting into detail. It really is simple with ThreatLocker. Ask any of our partners here. It's something that might be scary, but come and talk to us. It's not scary. The other thing we can do is then ring fence our application. So we can say, OK, well, Zoom, we have to use it. But we don't want it to call PowerShell. We don't want PowerShell to go out to the internet and access our files. Ring fence, build fences around the application so they have to stay in their lane. Denying by default is one of the most effective ways you can handle security. Now, that's not to say you should replace detection, but it's more important than hoping your antivirus is going to detect all the threats, as is ring fencing applications so they can't do anything. The problem is when you go to your customer and say, OK, we need to improve security, the most likely way you're going to go out of business, and that is a very powerful line, is a cyber breach. It's a fact, and everyone is vulnerable. Tesla, just last week, or no, not last, weeks ago and fast here, whatever, last month, an insider employee offered $500,000 to plug a USB device in Tesla. That's how much these guys are willing to go after the businesses. So when you say to your client, I want more security, they scream at you and they roar, you want more? What do you mean you want more? So what we need to do is we need to become the good guy. And one of the ways we can do that is obviously building trust. And there's two ways we can build trust. One is through reputation, and you should have that reputation, you should keep it. The other way is through demonstration. And the demo I'm not going to give you because we're short on time today, but if you are at Roadshow, you'll see it at Roadshow, is the USB rubber ducky. And for those who don't know, a rubber ducky essentially is a USB device. I have them in form of charging cables or anything, and it sends keystrokes to your computer. So it's not a storage device. It won't be blocked by USB storage. You plug it in, it sends keystrokes, and it can type at 1,000 words a minute. And the demonstration we do is uploading your files to the internet. We also have predefined scripts that can save your Chrome passwords, your Internet Explorer passwords, your Firefox passwords directly to the device. You can do all sorts of cyber attacks from it without any click. And they can come in the form of charging cables, USB devices. But it's a great tool. They're $50 to buy. ThreatLocker has a link of all predefined sample hacks so you can show your clients. And you can demonstrate to them why it's important. In this movie, these are the good guys, for those who don't watch movies, which is most of the room. And this is the cable repair guy that saved the world, because he knows something about computers. And he didn't go into the president and say, we're going to nuke him, or we're going to give him a virus. He went in and showed them. He put a Coke can on the spacecraft, and he asked somebody to shoot at it. Now, I suggest we don't shoot at our customers or their servers. It's not a good idea. But he asked somebody to shoot at the Coke can, and it bounced the bullet around the room. He then injected it with the virus without a USB port, any TCP IP traffic. I don't know how. He was a smarter guy than me. But he managed to inject the spacecraft with a virus, and then he repeated the exercise. That demonstration was incredibly powerful. And you can use similar demonstrations, whether it be through a rubber ducky or a pre-recorded video, or also stories of other clients that have been infected, to tell your customers why. It gives you credibility, and it also allows you to build almost a godlike structure where people think you're super smart, and then they're going to come to you for everything. So it's a great way of showing customers and explain how you're going to fix it and how it happened. So not at the deepest technical level. We don't need to know about bits and bytes, but we can give them a little bit of a high-level, business level, this is how we got into your network. I'm going to speed through this because I'm running low on time. I've got a little chart here, which is really about showing the customer the problem, explaining how, demonstrating solutions and value from those solutions, implementing it, and leave the door open. Don't say to your customer, this is going to make you secure. Promise your customer, we're going to keep fighting for you. We're going to keep investigating. We're going to keep looking at the threats and the market. And we're going to, our job, our responsibility is to tell you what you need to do. If you were an internal IT department, that's what you'd do. You wouldn't be concerned about, oh, this is my customer, I don't want to upset them. You'd go in and you'd, I remember standing in the boardroom in the enterprise IT roaring, and I was 23 years old because these guys were dumbasses as far as I was concerned. But you wouldn't step back and hold your feelings in because you don't want to upset the customer or your boss in the case of your internal IT. You shouldn't do that in the MSP. I'm not a big fan of packages, but I know it's a pretty common practice. But if you do use packages in your security, I always like to break them down like this. And this pricing and what's in them isn't necessarily important. I've put a basic package, which is the cheapest package you offer that has the least. The next two packages should be very close together in price and much higher in price. And the reason is you only ever want the customer to buy the Security Plus package. You don't care about the security. If you show two packages, they compare two. If you show three, they compare the two that are the closest together. And then they start looking at security versus Security Plus. That's $15 in the difference. It helps you build those packages. Now, I'm going to ask Neil to come up and help me with the demonstration here, because a few months ago, two weeks ago, I asked the MSP. An MSP said to me they couldn't be hacked. They couldn't get on their RMM. And I said I could. And I wasn't sure I could, but I asked him to do what an MSP would do. So I said, here's my situation. I'm your customer. Can you connect to my computer? Can you fix it? It's running Windows Update. It's running slow. So he connected to my machine. In this case, we're going to use TeamViewer, but it will work with any tool. And I'll give you access to this. And if you want to connect to my computer. So Neil's going to connect as the MSP from our sales guy's laptop, which we've turned off most of the security. So he's going to connect using TeamViewer. And while he's connected, I'm going to do a few things. So,
hang on, we're still connected, right?
Are we already connected?
Yeah. Oh, click. Disconnect and redo it.
Here we yes. go. Technology right. never works great.
Oh, no, right. Here we go. All right. So as Danny said, this could be any remote control tool. So. And oops, where did our thing go?
Share my screen. No, I'm just starting. Okay.
There we go. Okay.
The reason I pick on TeamViewer is because we haven't partnered with them, so they won't get upset by it.
So just imagine Danny's my customer, and he needs something fixed on his system, so I'm it's like something you do every day, right? Or at least your technicians do every day. They connect to a customer system, and they jump on to go, install a patch or something like that. So while
you're connected, Neil's going to log into his RMM like he normally does, not from my machine, but from his. So this
is a password manager. So I'm just opening up password manager, and I'm going to copy my password.
And while you do that, Neil, can I actually do one more thing? Can you just act normal like you would on your own computer in the day? Maybe send the sales team the Calendly link to book a ThreatLocker demo.
Yeah, so while I'm multitasking, the patching is running over here. On this side, I'm going to just do some other work. So let's see here. Which one am I on?
Hopefully Slack, you should be. Or any there browser will work.
So I copy that link, and I'm going to send it to the sales team. Did you see what just happened?
This is Adam's. Adam, were you on Tinder earlier on today? So that did not copy by the look of it, or did it copy? Well, it did copy, and I'll show you how it did copy. While you're connected to your customer's machines, you share something very, very important with them. You share their clipboard. And during this entire time, I have a few lines of code here in my Visual Studio that literally reads the data from the clipboard, outputs it to the screen, and replaces it with Tinder. Adam's going to get into trouble because he's been posting Pornhub and Tinder all over the sales chat room all day. And it's really embarrassing for the company. But the point is, I was able to do two things. One is, I was able to read the RMM password, which you can see on the screen here. which is not the RMM password, so taking pictures is not going to help. There's the RMM password. The other thing I was able to do was copy the Calendly link, and I was able to replace it with Tinder. Now, the MSP that connected to my machine, I replaced it one other thing, too. I replaced his file, so he copied a file on his computer, and I replaced it with a piece of malware. So he thought he was copying and pasting files on his own machine, but what he was actually copying and pasting was my malware, which said boo. Now, I didn't have the code this morning, so I rewrote this and while I was sitting out there at the table, and it was like 4 lines to hijack the clipboard. That's all it took, 4 lines of code. It took about 30 or 40 lines of code to replace an executable in the clipboard. The point is you might think I'm safe and there's no way malware can get on my machine. There's always something we don't think about. And you guys connect to your clients' machines all the time. So you need to do more to make sure you harden your environment. You need to make sure your applications don't have access to things they shouldn't be. Figure out when you're sharing clipboards. And hopefully, at least everyone goes home tonight and says, when I'm connected to a customer's machine, I'm going to be really, really careful. And because I don't know that their machine can't infect me, and I don't know that they're not copying and pasting my passwords. If you have done things like this before, copy and paste while you're connected to your customer's machine, which you probably have, do me at least one other favor. Go home and change your passwords, because they might be sitting on your customer's machine without you even thinking about it. Neil's obviously a gold partner at ThreatLocker, and I do appreciate you helping us with this demo today. And Adam will talk about your Tinder issues later on today, so if we can keep that out of the clipboard. But we've got a couple of minutes left, so I don't know if anyone has any questions. Oh, thank you. Yeah. You can stay.
No. Yeah. I was going to.
Any questions, anybody? Go ahead. So the 4 lines of code are running on my computer as the client. So you connected to your client's computer, and they were infected with the malware. So while you were connected to your client's computer, the clipboard is shared between your computer and your client's computer. So they were running it. And in the case I actually did it with the MSP, it wasn't even running on the machine they connected to. It was running on my physical machine, which they were connecting to a Hyper-V image inside of it. So I even went one step further back. But essentially, when you connect, you share the clipboard with your client. So any malware running on your client can access or manipulate your clipboard. So if you have something in your clipboard, they can read it, and they can also change it. So in this case, we changed it to Tinder. We could have changed it to malware or anything else. Go ahead.
Did the person that you connected to, were they running two-factor for their RMM tool, and would that have made
it? So there's an absolute perfect example of why you should use controls. We have to assume that someone's going to get our password. And if they had two-factor, now, there are some things about two-factor with API keys that it's not as great as you think, just in case you think that. But if they were running two-factor, there's a physical control that didn't matter that their password was exposed. But yes, if they were running two-factor, I couldn't have got into their RMM. I didn't actually try and get into their RMM. The deal was I was going to put malware on the machine, and I was going to get their RMM password. Go ahead.
So at what point in the attack was his RMM password exposed? I think I missed that part.
So he was working in the background, and while he was connected to my machine, he was connected for nearly the entire day running Windows updates. So while he was connected, he was logging in and out of his password manager, and he copied the password from his password manager to log into his RMM.
Oh, okay.
So when you use that copy function, it shared the password.
Gotcha, okay, yeah.
Anybody else? Nope. I did a great job explaining it well then. Okay, guys, I do appreciate everyone's time today. You know, think about security. There's no such thing as completely secure. You can do a lot of things. You can implement zero trust. You can implement default deny, which is really going to harden your environment. And you can ring fence applications so they don't have unlimited access to your clipboard and unlimited access to your files or your data or things like that. If you don't already use ThreatLocker, I know a lot of people here do use ThreatLocker, you know, come by, talk to us, sign up for a demo, sign up for a trial. For anyone who does a trial, now this part's important because people get confused on this part. If you do a trial of ThreatLocker on 100 endpoints and you lock down those 100 endpoints, they have to be locked down, you have to try it. We're not asking people to just click sign up for a trial. We're going to send you out a rubber ducky, and we're going to send you out all of our scripts with all the ways you can copy your customers' passwords, you can show them how to change their background to some inappropriate images or whatever else, or replace their thing with Tinder. Did you have a question there, sorry?
So what Would ThreatLocker have stopped you from doing this?
So ThreatLocker would have done two things, and it wouldn't have completely stopped me. One is, unless I blocked access to the clipboard completely. So the new version of ThreatLocker allows clipboard ring fencing. So currently our ring fencing stops access to files, it stops access to registry, internet, other applications. You could block the clipboard exe. We have a new feature that actually stops the clipboard being shared completely. It would also stop the virus executing on the machine in the first place, so the client wouldn't have been able to run it. And in that case, it would have stopped the clipboard, but it also wouldn't have been able to execute on the MSP's machine when he copied and pasted his file, thinking it was his file it was running. They just said boo, by the way. It didn't actually do anything. Okay, guys, girls, I appreciate everybody's time. Thank you very much. And you know, drop by to the booth. We are giving away $500 cash tomorrow. To get the $500 cash, put your card in the ThreatLocker bowl or cup or whatever it is out there. And make sure you're wearing a ThreatLocker t-shirt. And make sure it's visible. It's not OK. If we draw your name and it's underneath your top, you get to draw the next person. And that's a privilege. You get to draw the real winner. So come and grab a t-shirt before we run out. Last week in Indiana, there was a 400-pound guy wearing a medium t-shirt. And it didn't look so good. So come and grab one before the good sizes run out. Guys, thank you very much.